Praise God. You have your Bible with you. We will go to Mark chapter 7. And let's all stand to honor God's word. Mark chapter 7. I entitled our message this morning, Fall and Redemption. Again, Jesus called, Mark chapter 7 from verse 14 to 23. Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can define them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them." After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? For it doesn't go into their hearts, but into their stomach, and then out of the body." In saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. Wow, praise God. Probably some of you are saying there right now, "Yes, I can eat now more barbecue steaks." He went on, "What comes out of a person is what defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come. Amen. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evil come from the inside and defile a person." Hallelujah. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come before your throne of grace this morning, God. We ask, Lord God, that through your Holy Spirit, you will break down every wall in our heart, in our minds, in our thoughts, so that we may see where we stand. Help us, Lord, to see where we are, so that you can transform us, O God, and build us, made us according to your image as your original plan. Thank you, God. We give you the highest praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' awesome name. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You know, the gospel which is from Matthew to John, it was called the gospel. No, the New Testament is called the gospel. It means what? Good news. Are you with me, church? Or are you already in vacation? The gospel means what?
Good news.
Good news. Good news. It was called good news because there is bad news. Amen? It was called good news because there is a bad news. Now, for example, you go to the doctor, you know, and after checkup, blood testing, and everything, you are waiting. What will be the result of that checkup? And in your mind, you are anticipating because of the things that you are feeling. Oh, I have this. Probably I already inherit the sickness of the family. You know, the big C and everything. You know, I have a high this, high that, you know, and you were thinking of many things. And then finally the results comes and the doctor calls you to report to him. No? And the doctor said, "You have a clean bill of health." What is that? That is good news. Because you are anticipating a bad news, but you receive a good news. Are you with me, church? In other words, we anticipate there is bad news, that's why there is good news. Amen. For some, no, we are thinking, finally, she's at the face getting married. Wow, that's good news. Diba? That's good news because we are thinking Atipe will never get married. Then suddenly there was this guy and suddenly Atipe right there said, "Oh, Atipe is getting married." That's good news. Diba? Probably Brother Arnold will buy two religion because he was so happy for that news. Diba? Yesterday we heard about news. about the Santa Barbara shooting. Di ba? About the Santa Barbara shooting. I just have, because we are visiting a family, I just have a glimpse of the news in the television. But I saw in the flash that they have 8 people died. So all of us look at that and we see that's bad news. Our world is messed up. Di ba? Most of the time, we do not hear those kind of bad news. But people who are working, you know, in the field like a policeman, yeah, they always stumble with this kind of news because our world is messed up. Now the social worker, for example, now they are always unto this bad news. Oncologists, for example, doctors, especially the oncologists, they are always stumble with this bad news, no? Lagi nilang nasasalubong, no? They always stumble to the bad news because our world is messed up. Amen? And for us to understand when this bad news started, no, we need to go back to the history of man. We need to go back to the beginning. That is where our quiet time right now. We are in the book of Genesis, right? So, while reading it, no, I discovered that in the beginning, the Father is the author of the creation. The true in God, no, combine themselves together, no, and in the canvas of creation, the Father is the author. The Son is the driving force. No, He is the creative force. The Word of God says, teach us that nothing is made without Him. And then the Holy Spirit, which is the breath or the life that gives to every creation. So the true in God, no, make the canvas of creation. And the Bible teaches us, the Word of God teaches us that everything that they made, God says, and it was what? Where are you now? Good. Everything was made was good. It was like in orchestra. There's a harmony. No, there's a rhythm. No, that everybody is in rhythm. Everything is good. When you know, when you are in orchestra, and you know, every one of them should be harmonious to everyone. Diba? Everybody should be in rhythm. Now, if one guy, you know, he wants to show off, he will break the rhythm. And you will immediately know who is that guy. You can point out who is that guy. Because everyone is in rhythm. Harmoniously sounds together. So that's what it is. In the beginning, when God created everything, everybody sounds not good, harmoniously good, sounds perfect. In fact, it is a shalom, peace. It's a perfect peace. No, not like the world we are living right now. In that garden, in that paradise, in that creation, there's only one rule. And that rule, it says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 16. And the Lord God commanded the man, you are free to eat from any tree in the garden. That's the only rule in that garden. That he can eat any tree except for that one tree in the garden. But you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of the good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die. Amen? I want you to know that obedience brings joy in our life. When we obey, it brings joy in our life. When we submit to the will of God, it's a good thing. Amen? When we submit to the will of God, submission is a good thing. When we submit to the will of God, it's good for us. Amen? Everything will be harmonious. We will be in rhythm. That everything is good. Are you still with me, church? Amen. And then there is this Eve. Amen. There is this Eve with her passive husband. They're walking in the garden one day. Both of them are naked and there's no shame. And then there is this serpent. And then there is this serpent. Diba? And the serpent lied and deceived Eve. Did you notice that the serpent did not talk to
to the husband, but to the wife.
Tumawa yung mga lalaki.
Did you notice that? That the serpent did not talk to the husband, but to the wife. In my Bible study, you know, I asked the group, because that's our Bible study, why do you think that the serpent talked to the wife? And they said, oh, because the wife is weak, the wife can be easily lead into, you know, huh? You know, that's why the serpent talked to the wife, you know. Now, I want you to understand that the commandment of God was given to Adam and not to Eve. That's why the serpent know that. That's why the serpent talked to Eve. Because if you do not have God's word, you can easily be deceived. Amen. If you don't have the God's word, you can be easily deceived. Now, I want you to understand, before Eve came, Adam was so busy naming all the animals. When he see the elephant, he said, that may be called that elephant. He's wise. He saw the lion, he said, that may be called lion. And he names all the animals. Di ba? And everything is in harmony, in rhythm. All is good. Until the serpent came and deceived Eve. And what happened? There is an outright rebellion is declared against the King of Glory. And the harmony, the rhythm is broken. Peace is broken. Now there is shame. There is understanding of nakedness. They run. Sin make us run. Sin make us hide. Amen? You know that when two person, man and a woman, and probably man and men, you know that if they are in sin, you know, they're walking in the street. The man is walking ahead of the woman. Why? Because they're hiding. Right? The woman is walking very away from man. They're hiding. Sins make us hide. Hello?
Amen.
Amen? And sin not just make us hide. Sin make us dumb. Why? You see, this couple hide from the Creator of heaven and earth. He just created heaven and earth. He could see beyond, and they hide on the tree. Isn't it dumb? Yeah? Amen? Sin make us dumb. Make us do dumb things. Isn't it? And so the Lord called the man. And the Lord said to the man, what have you done, Adam? Lord, it's not my fault. It's your fault because you gave me a woman. Isn't it? Adam blamed the Lord. You gave me the woman. Probably if it is this time today, the Lord asked, what happened, Adam? I don't know, Lord. I came home. Busy from work, I came home for dinner, and this is what happened. I have no idea, I have no clue. He said, because of the woman. And to the woman, God said, woman, what have you done? I don't know. It's the serpent. You see, that's the problem in relationship when nobody will admit their guilt. Because of that, there is a reordering of creation from how God designed it into what you and I currently live in. It's become messed up. There is now strife when there is peace before. There is now chaos when there is shalom. Unbelievable violence when there is no violence at all. Amen. Romans chapter 8, it says that out the creation is waiting for that one big day again when everything will be in harmony. Now it says in Romans chapter 8, verse 19 to 21. For all creation is waiting eagerly for that future day when God will reveal who His children really are. Against its will, all creation was subjected to God's curse, but with eager hope, The creation looks forward to the day when it will join God's children in glorious freedom from death and decay. You see, the creation, the environment where we live in right now, amen, it was subject to God's curse. The creation was cursed. And everything is messed up. Are you with me, church? That's the bad news. That's the bad news. No? We are waiting for the day what Prophet Isaiah had called that one day this is what will happen. Like Isaiah 11 verse 6 to 7, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the goat, the calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, the young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. Today, when the wolf and the lamb live together, there's problem. The wolf has a dinner. Isn't it? Amen. Today, it's not happening. Why? Because out the creation is a curse. The world we are living is messed up. There is no peace. There is no shalom. That's the bad news. Amen? You see, when God put Adam to sleep, no? And then when he wake up, he see this beautiful woman. No? And we heard the first song of the Bible. It says, sa si Sunny. Kinakanta to lagi ni Sunny, always singing this song. Kay Roda. And also my mom. He's now bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. Dandan. Diba? The first song of the Bible. Which means, the woman, which means, literally means, mine. Husband, where's the husband? Can you say, mine? Mine. That's the meaning of literally means, the woman literally means mine. Now, problem occurred. Now, the woman lead the man to eat that fruit. I said, man, what have you done? This woman! But before he said, that's mine. But now when problem occurred, this woman, he just threw that woman on the bus. No, because no one likes to take the responsibility. When no one wants to take the responsibility in relationship, it creates havoc. It creates chaos. Amen? Because of their sin, pain is amplified. God said to the woman, you will be having a hard time now to bear children in your childbirth, in birthing children. Amen. Are you with me, church? Now the work become works. When before, work is not toilsome, it's not burdensome. Now because of curse, because they have break the rhythm, they break their harmony, work become toilsome, it become burdensome. They no longer enjoy work. Amen? It's become exhausting. It's become toilsome because of my fault. That is bad news. Amen? And this is the big one of all the bad news. The Lord says to them, from dust to dust you will return. Death is always hanging in our head when something is not right in our life. Amen. Death is now hanging over our head because of that curse, because of that simple act that they have done. Death is now all over us. It's always hanging on our head. That is bad news. Are you with me, church? Because of the sin of that one, of Adam and Eve. Diba? They try to redeem themselves. Now they try to redeem themselves. God helped them to redeem themselves. They could not redeem themselves. No, they covered themselves. Remember, they covered themselves. No, they trying to redeem their nakedness, their shame. They try to cover their shame. You know, but they could not. No? That's why the Word of God says here that creation is waiting for that day that it can be restored again. Because we know our world is messed up. For example, when we get sick, we know something is wrong. Amen. When children, no, when sons and daughters die before their parents, we know something is wrong. Amen. We try to solve and fix things. Amen. We try to redeem ourselves. We try to reconcile, to rescue ourselves, but to no avail, we cannot do it. I want you to know that's the bad news. We cannot do it by our own. Just like Adam and Eve, most of us, we do it in our own. We try to fix, reconcile, and resolve and rescue ourselves. That's what Adam and Eve, that's the meaning of the tree, the leaves that covers them. But they could not cover themselves in their nakedness. Are you with me, church? There are four places that we run to when we are wrong, when we are in problem, when we need to be fixed. We run to these four places. No? We run to ourselves. Number one. No? We run to ourselves. No? We think that a better version of ourselves will be good. No? 10 years from now, you said to yourself, this is my plan. 10 years from now, no, I will be better. No, I will be a better person, for example. I will be a better young man, a better husband, a better father. No, we think that a better version of ourselves will be good enough. No? You know Karen Carpenter? No? She died of, I hope I pronounced it correctly, anorexia nervosa. That is a twisted perception of reality that leads to death of a person. This person is already thin. No? If you see a person that in this condition, they are very thin, they are just skin and bone, and yet they look at the mirror and they still see that they are fat. Diba? We in Karen Carpenter, we still hear it. Her song, no, we just lost a good talent because of a twisted perception of herself. In other words, we have a twisted perception of ourselves. Not all of us, but most of us like that. We cannot really see who we are, where we are, where we're going. So even the best version of yourself 10 years from now is still will never be good enough for God. He said, I will never drink again. I will never go to this bar again. I will never do this again. I will be a good husband and everything. I will do things. I want you to understand, without the help of God, you will never be good enough for God. The Bible says that our righteousness is just a dirty rags in the eyes of God. Amen? So we run to ourselves to try to fix our problems. Amen? And then, when we see that we cannot fix ourselves, we run for another help. No, we run to others. For example, some of you women, or men as well, you were thinking, oh, if I marry that boy, if I marry him, my life will be complete. He completed me. And after a while, you will realize that no one really completed you. No one will really satisfy you except God. Amen? Because your husband or your wife is no God at all. He can never be a God in your life. Amen. Or probably, oh, if I will be belong to this group, if I will be belong to these schoolmates, to this friend, to this neighborhood, I will be better. Diba? If I will be belong to this friend, I will be better. I want you to know that if you put an expectation to your friend, to your spouse, to fill that emptiness in your life, you are just sowing conflict to yourself. They can't do it. It's impossible. Amen? Because if you put so high of expectation to anyone, to your friends, to your husband, to anyone, even to your relatives, they will fail you. They will not satisfy you completely. Amen? Because we have expectation to the other person that could never be. Amen? They will fail us. Amen? So if you go to that person and thinking, this person will satisfy you, this person will help you, amen? And completely, you are moving towards conflict. You are moving towards conflict. Why? Because if that expectation did not match as what you desire, then conflicts will begin. Your completeness, your fullness is in Christ. Amen. Your husband, your wife can never be your God. Your friend can never be your God. Only Jesus. Are you with me, church? Some of us, we run towards the, no, because of bad news, no, we run to fix ourselves, to preach the, what's wrong with us, we run to ourselves, or we run to others to complete us, no, or some of us, we run to the world. What do we mean we run to the world? When I was young, I was thinking that if I will be able to have money, I will be good in life. Amen? So my pastor told me at that time, Brother Jesse, he said, money, God has a call in your life. I said, yes. Thank you, Lord. I could see how you preach. No, the Lord is anointing you. Yes. Then I heard that Christy's mom is planning to make her married to a British guy. No, the friend of her uncle. And I said, if only I have money, no, I could have everything. I could have Christy, you know, and I'll be happy. So I ran to Saudi Arabia. And for my first 3 years in Saudi Arabia, my life is in chaos. No, living I'm not satisfied. Why? Because I'm in a place that God has not called me. For my first 3 years. Because on the fourth year, I go back to God. We started again a Bible study. And again, no, because my first 3 years, I kind of look warm. You know, I become Christian when I go back to the Philippines. Then we go back to Saudi Arabia. You know, I kind of look warm. I do not do bad stuff, you know. But I just have no time to God. That's all. I didn't do drinks or gambling. I just don't have time with God until I have the fourth year. I have a Bible study again and started to live for God again. What I'm saying is that I thought stuff of the world will complete me, will satisfy me. You know, in Saudi, I was able to buy good glasses. You know, Ray-Ban at the time is on the top, and I bought the top of the line in Ray-Ban. No? I bought top of the line in amplifier, in speaker, and everything. It's always on the top of the line. I have my watch as a Rado. I have a good necklace. And you know, and these good stuffs, it's kind of like have a drug high. You know, you feel good about yourself. You're thinking, man, I'm a better person. Am I become a better person? No. I'm just a person with a staff. But I'm not a better person. Are you with me, church? So the staff of the world will not make us a better person. It will make us feel better, but it will not make us a better person. Amen. The new stuff has like a drug effect on all of us. It makes us high. It makes us feel better. Yeah, man, look at my watch, man. It's Rado, man, Rado. Rado. Amen. You are not any better. You are just have a new stuff. Are you with me, church? Amen. Now, I want you to understand that the stuff that we have, the things that we have from this world, is just transient. What do I mean? It's just there for a season. Amen. It's just there for a season. Where's my Rado now? It's gone. Now, because I live in close to the sea, now because of my perspiration, yung pawis ko, and it become, now it's corroded and it's gone. Where's the amplifier, the Pioneer, and the AR speaker that I have? It's gone. It's broken. Amen. All of those stuff, the gold that I have, it's gone. Amen. Praise God, I still have this woman. Amen? None of those things, none of those stuffs makes you a better person. So when we run to the world thinking we become a better person, the world can fix our things, it's not. It's bad news. Amen? And some of it, we indulge ourselves, we crave ourselves, we make up cravings. For example, we run to food. Not the food of the world. We run to the wine of the world. No, we drown ourselves thinking that, you know, it will fix our things. No, and some men, no, even went as far as having a multiple relationship thinking it will fix their problem. It will solve their emptiness. It will complete their lives. We all of know, we have seen in television how marriages end up in divorce, how marriages having several relationships. Why? Because it never solved the problem. It never can fix the problem. Only God can fix our problem. Are you with me? That poor thing that we went going to is the religion. Now, some people go to religion. Now, our problem with the religion is that we have a deity. No, the religion of the world, for example, they have a deity that they need to peace. A peace. Amen? They need, for example, you need to become a better person to appease this God. You have to become a better than your neighbor. You see, I should be a better than my neighbor, so my God, this God will show favor in my life. We always do things, no, so that we feel that God, this God, can receive and accept us. We need to be a better person. I want you to understand, religion does not work. Hello? Amen? One day, C.S. Lewis, and his co-professor wants to trap him because they know he's a Christian, so they want to trap him. So they write on the board, because all of them are professors, they write on the board different kinds of religion. For example, Hinduism, Buddhist, Jehovah's Witness, Catholic, Protestant, and every religion that you can name, they write it on the board. You know? And so when Lewis come to this room, C.S. Lewis, they ask C.S. Lewis, so what do you think is the difference of Christianity over those religion? Thinking that C.S. Lewis will be dropped, could not answer. And C.S. Lewis simply told them, oh, it's simple. It's grace. Simple. It's grace. Because Christianity, we are not believing God, not doing good things so that He can love us, so that He can give us favor. No, we are all under grace. Sinner under grace of God. Amen. I'm not better than you. I'm preaching here because I'm better than you. No, I'm like you under the grace of God. Amen. God did not choose me because I'm better than you. No, I'm just here because I am under the grace of God. We are all under the grace of God. So, ourselves, others, the world, even religion cannot fix our bad news. Cannot fix the conflict that we have within. The emptiness that we have within. They cannot fix it. Only God. That's why the prophet Isaiah invited us in Isaiah 55 verse 1 and 2. He said, come all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen to me and eat what is good and you will delight in the riches of faith. Prophet Isaiah is inviting us, the Lord is inviting us through Prophet Isaiah, why spend your life on the things that will not satisfy, things that will not complete you? Come to me because I'm the only one that can satisfy you. Amen. Are you in the church? Amen. This is the world where we are in right now. It's a total mess. It's in chaos. without shalom, without order, without harmony. Amen. Now, once in a while, we hear it from ourselves. For example, a relative of this has just died, or a relative of that has just have a sickness. We hear this bad news personally. But when we go to our television, when we go to our internet, we see this every day, every time of this bad news. Why? Because creation is under curse because of sin. Amen? In our reading this morning, no, it says, let's go back to our reading this morning. Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them." After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciple asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? For it doesn't go into their heart, but into their stomach, and then out of the body." Amen. The Lord is saying to them in these verses that what is unclean is already inside of you. Hello? Amen. Amen. What is unclean is already inside of you. It's not your activity that makes you sinful. It's not what you do that makes you sinful in life. Amen? What makes you unclean is already inside of you. In other words, you don't do sinful act to make you a sinner. You are a sinner, so you do sinful act. I'll repeat myself. I said, you don't do sinful act or activity to make you a sinner. You are a sinner, so you do sinful act. Amen? Are you with me, church?
Amen.
You do not commit adultery because you do not sin because you commit adultery. You already sinner, that's why you commit adultery. Or you become a drunkard. Because it's already inside of you. That's what the Bible tells us. Amen? Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? In other words, it's not your activity that makes you a sinner. You are already a sinner, that's why you make those kind of activity. Are you with me, church? Hello? Amen? That's why some of us now will try to become a better person. No, I will be a better father, a better employee, a better student, but we still fail. Why? Because inside is not changed. Because the problem, according to Jesus, is our inside. The problem is you. You're the problem. Your heart is the problem. The problem is inside of you. You can't fix it. Are you with me, church? Behavior modification is just a temporary fix. Amen? It's a temporary fix. Yesterday we were at Christie's family, his cousin-in-law sharing that she could not stop smoking. She has 6 children. She said, "Every time I'm pregnant, I will stop smoking because I'm afraid my children will have it. But after I give birth, after breastfeeding, I go back." Why? Because inside was not changed. They are temporary behavior modification, but until sin heart is changed, it will never work. Because whatever reigns and rule in your heart will always overflow out of your heart into your action and attitudes. Amen. Whatever rules and reigns in your heart will automatically overflow into your action and into your attitude. Amen. Ultimately, if you don't get to the bottom, if you don't get down to those roots, it will just spring up back. Lilitaw uli, lalabas uli. Are you with me, church? Amen. If you don't deal with the roots, with the core of the problem, When the bottom of the heart, if you did not dig it out, amen, it will just come out again. So you need to dig with the problem. You need to dig to the heart. You need to dig out the roots.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Here in California, we always see weeds. You know, and what happened? We just take out the weeds. And then after a few days, we see the weeds springing back. Why? Because we did not take out the roots.
Amen.
We did not deal with the roots.
Amen.
Amen. So whatever is ruling and reigning in your heart will always overflow out of your heart into your action and attitude. Amen.
Amen.
So we need to deal with it. Otherwise, it will be just cycle, come back to the old patterns. Amen. And you know, if we did not deal it, when something spring up again, there will be bitterness, there will be anger, there will be again forgiveness. There, if something happened, then new things will flare up. Amen. Why? Because we never deal with the problem. We never deal with the roots. We need to deal with the roots. And according to Jesus, the root is our heart. The problem is our heart. Amen. He went on to say, what comes out of a person is what defiled them. For it is from
within.
Is it clear, church?
Yeah.
It is from within. So we are not sin because of our activity, the things that we do outside. We do these things because of what's already inside of us. Amen? Our heart is not changed. Out of a person's heart, the evil thoughts come. Out of a person's heart, the evil thoughts come. Amen? What are those evil thoughts? Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All this evil comes from inside and defile a person. Look what Jesus is saying. You can never blame anyone of your action because you already think of this. That's why it happens. Hello? Oh, the devil made me do it. The drugs made me do it. No, you have a cravings for the drugs. That's why when you were drug in under the influence of drug, that's why you are able to do it. Amen. Don't blame drugs. Don't blame the enemy. According to Jesus, that evil thoughts come from within. From where? From the heart. Amen. We all lie. Isn't it? But none of us will admit that we are a liar. Hello? Isn't it? We have to deal with the root of the problem. Amen? Jesus said, when we just look, we already commit what? Adultery. It's on the thoughts, in our mind. Amen? When we feel unclean, we run. When we think can fix ourselves, fix our problem. When we feel defiled, we run. We try to fix ourselves, we run to others. We run to the world. We run to religion. But they cannot help us. We find out that they cannot help us. Diba? We are all down. We cannot fix ourselves. I repeat. We are all down. We cannot fix ourselves. Unless Jesus help us.
Amen.
Unless Jesus help us. Are you with me, church? That's the bad news. Then there is a good news. That's the good news. Jesus is willing to help us. That's the good news. Amen? For news to be good, it must invade the bad news. I'll repeat. For news to be good, it must invade, it must overcome, it must defeat the bad news. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible, that's bad news. But the good news is, but the gift of God, amen? But the gift of God is salvation through Christ Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. For the wages of sin is death, that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. That is good news.
Amen.
That is good news. Amen. Let's go to Romans chapter 5. Amen. How we transform our heart. Because according to the word of God, our problem is a person's heart. Our problem is our heart. Amen. So how do we change our heart when the heart of our problem is the our heart? Nakuha niyo ba yun? Catchy, no? How do you solve the problem when the heart of the problem is your heart? Amen? In other words, the real issue is not your addiction, no? It's not your struggle, it's not your loneliness, it's not your depression, it's not your marriage, it's not your lust, no? It's not your addiction. The real issue is your heart. That's the real issue in your life. Your heart. So how do we transform our heart? We go to Romans chapter 5 and we will begin in verse 6. While we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Hallelujah! When we are still what? Weak. When we are still weak. Amen? Some people said, oh, Christianity is just a crutch. Yes! Absolutely! Because I'm crippled by sin. Sin break my legs. And I need the crutch. The help of God so I can stand again. Are you with me, church? Someone said Christianity is for a weak mind. Absolutely! I have a weak mind. I have evil thoughts. That's why I need the mind of Christ.
Amen.
Are you with me, church? The Lord says, while we're still weak, now we have a problem in our culture. We could not admit that we are weak. Hello? Now we are proud. We could not admit that we need help. Amen? When in the Philippines, I realize now that it's easy to ask for direction. Here in America, they do not want to do that because they don't want to feel that they are weak or dumb. Isn't it? For example, in Walmart, we do not want to ask the Walmart, even though it says there, how may I help you? We do not want to ask them for help. Because our perception is that we are strong. We can do it. We do not glorify weakness. Are you with me, church? We want to be strong. We want to be independent. We can do it. We tell ourselves, I can do it. I can make it. But Jesus said, while we were still weak. Amen? You know, the Bible says, God loves the weak. He takes glory to those who are weak. To those who said, Lord, I cannot do it without your help. God is glorified and He's very willing to help that to shame the strong. Don't blame me. Blame the Bible, it says in Corinthians. God feels chosen the weak to shame the strong. To shame to those who think they can do it themselves without God. That they can be independent without God. God says, oh, I need this person. I can use this person who said, Lord, those who prayed and asked God, I need your help. God says, now you're ready for promotion. Now you're ready for help. Until you are independent, you can do it all yourself. God is back up and He's just waiting for you to say, Lord, I need your help. A good example of that is Moses. Moses is a Hebrew, grew up in Egypt home. Not just an Egypt home, he grew up in the palace of the Pharaoh. Amen? And he saw every day, he knew that he is a Hebrew by blood. And he wants to help his people. So one day he saw, he his co-Hebrew was being maltreated of slavery. So what he did, he killed this person. He do it by himself to help this person. What happened? At 40, he runs away from Pharaoh's policemen. At the age of 40, very young. At the age of 40, probably we can say today, he is at his peak of his age of his life. He has made it, he's already executive, but he runs towards the wilderness at 40. At the age of 80, God said, this man is now ready. I already retrained him for 40 years. Now he's ready, I will use him. Pastor, how did you know that he's ready? Because when God says, Moses, I will send you back. Lord, I can't do it. I cannot do it. Please choose another one. I'm not ready. God said, that's why I choose you. Because you're not ready of your own. That's why you need my help. Now you're ready. Go. Are you in the church? Amen. God is glorified when we are weak. When we said, Lord, I need your help. Listen. While we are still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. In other words, when we are still active in our rebellion against God, He died for us. He did not wait until we become good. He did not wait until we become acceptable. The Word of God says, when we are still active in our rebellion against God, God died for us.
Amen.
He died for us. Amen. When? At the right time. Now I want to post this. So when you pray for your friends, when you pray for your classmates, when you pray for your neighbor, pray, Lord, I pray that this will be the right time for him to know you.
Amen.
This is the right time that he will understand that he is weak without you, God. Lord, let my father know that this is the right time. He is weak without your love, without your salvation. Lord, I pray this is his right time. For me, my right time to be saved is when I am 16 years old. For some, when they are 60. For some, when they are 20s, in their 40s, in their 30s. I don't know when is the right time. I just knew is this. God died for us while we were yet sinners. Hallelujah! Let's clap the Lord. Let's give a clap offering to God. When we are yet sinners. And that, my friend, is good news. That is the heart of the gospel. While we are still enemy of God, He died for us. While we are still enemy of God, Christ died for us. When you are in rebellion, when you are in your weakest, amen? When you are in your weakest, in God's appointed time, He rescued you. He helped you. He makes you stand again. Are you with me, church? Why one will hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for a good man, one will dare even to die. But God showed His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we are now justified by His blood, much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God. Hallelujah. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What Christ had done? While we were yet sinners, when we have accepted Christ, my friend, God gave us a new heart. Because our problem is our heart. Are you with me, church? That's why God made an operation when we accepted Christ and invade our darkness. Invade the good news, invade our darkness. While what? While we were yet sinners. This is good news because no matter what you do, my friend, you are not good enough for God. I'll repeat myself. No matter what you do, you are not good enough for God. So don't come to God trying to appease Him because you are good. Because no matter what you do, you are not enough. Your righteousness is not enough for God. You need the righteousness of Christ. to be in you. That's why the Bible says, he who have no sin becomes sin, so that his righteousness will become our righteousness.
Amen.
This is good news, my friend, because it's saying to us that when we run to ourselves, it will fail you. When you run to others, it will not satisfy you. When you run to the world, it will not complete you. When you run to the real religion, it will never satisfy you. But when you run to Christ, understanding today that nothing separates you between Christ and yourself. It's good news because you know that you can come to God even while you were sinners. The enemy will try to stop you and tell you how bad you are. So you make yourself to become good. But the good news is you don't need to be good to be accepted because Christ already died for you while you were yet sinners.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He will not love you more because of what you have done, good things that you have done. No. He have loved you because He loves you. Amen. Are you with me, church? For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son. Amen. Much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by His life. Not only so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received our reconciliation. We run to God for his help. Because now we understand we are the problem and we can fix ourselves only by Jesus. Amen. We completely now, according to the Word of God, we are reconciled because of the death of His Son. Now, because of that, amen, we can trust completely the finished work of Christ.
Amen.
Are you with me, church? I hope you will feel the liberty that we have in Christ. When before we are like Adam and Eve, hiding because we have seen our nakedness, we have seen our shame, we have seen the bad news in our life. Now, according to this verse, we are already reconciled to God. There is no longer shame. We can go to God with our nakedness and say to God, God, I am naked. I am in shame. This is what's my heart. I need you to fix my heart, to fix inside of me, to set me free from this anger, from this bitterness, from this jealousy, from these things that imprison me, God. Because I cannot fix myself. I am weak. But I am ready to trust you completely. To trust your finished work in Christ.
Amen.
Bam! That's the good news, my friend. You have no longer need to labor. Because you are already accepted. Because Christ reconciled you.
Amen.
Picture this. When you said, Lord, forgive me. Picture this. Jesus will go to the Father. Father, I want you to meet my friend Manny. He said he cannot fix himself. He admit that he failed. And he is weak. Father, I want you to remember what I did on the cross. Because he's pleading for the power of the cross. Father, will you accept my friend? I'm bringing my friend. That's what Christ had done. He reconciled us to Father. So that we who are called enemies can be called again friend of God.
Amen.
Friend of God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We can be called again friend of God. Amen. By knowing this, we admit to God, Lord, I'm not going to make myself better for you, Lord, because I know I can't. On my best day, I still fall short of your expectation to me. On my best day, I feel short of your expectation to me. You know, when I was in grade 6, my grandfather was called into the school. And Mrs. Huertas, my advisor at the time, Mrs. Huertas, complained to my grandfather, to my lolo. She said, I'm very active in school. I make everybody noisy. I make I stand on the top of the table, do Elvis Presley, and all this kind of stuff. You know, the classroom. I know it's money because when I went to the restroom, coming back, I heard my pupil shouting and laughing and throwing everything. And the starter is your abode. You know, and I feel very ashamed. Now I'm very shy because I put this disgrace on my grandfather. I was so ashamed of myself to my grandfather. So I said to myself, I will change. I will not bring this shame anymore to my grandfather. Because of his love, he accepted me, and I don't want to repay him of this shame. So I tried to fix myself. First 3 months on first year high school, I'm good. I'm going home. I did not mess up. But after that, again, go back to my old nature. Again, I said, probably in my second year, try. Probably on my third year, fail. Probably on my fourth year, again, fail. Until I find Jesus in my life. And He fixed me. My friend, I share this message to you this morning because I want you to understand what David has shared to us in Psalms 40. I was in the mud, I was in the pit, and you helped me. And you clean me. Probably today, you need that help. Probably you feel you're strong. You can fix yourselves. You run to yourselves. You run to others. You run to the stuff of the world. You even run to religion. And it never fixes you. It never helps you. Because your true help comes only to the finished cross. Finished work at the cross of Jesus Christ. Probably you have a parent, or a friend, or a classmate, or a husband, or a wife, that right now is empty, incomplete, does not satisfy. Christ is inviting us. He said, come to me. Why spend your money or your life on the things that will not satisfy you? Come to me and you will be complete. Come to me and you will be satisfied. Your completeness in a full trust of me. Will you come to Christ this morning? Will you come to God this morning? Because He's the only one who can complete your life. Let's all stand.